Hi, welcome to the final session of today. They told me they will be showing the time for us on this panel, so I imagine it's going to start. It's going to be shorter than the rest of the sessions because we're already, I understand, a bit late. But welcome to the session, Smart Cities, Utilising New Technologies and Innovation for Better Solutions and Policies. I know most of the panel. I have a couple of people that in my daily work, they're like next door to me and some in the next building. So it's very nice to have this panel. We have a lovely panel that comes from the municipalities, from organizations for social responsibility that review this and do this from the European perspective, and also from research organizations like Cyens and KIOS, as well as the Deputy Ministry of Research and Innovation. So let me introduce the speakers. It's Ms. Nadia Lortzie, Smart City Officer. Hello, Nadia. It's Ms. Elena Poulli. She's the Officer A at the Deputy Ministry of Research and Innovation. It's Christos Laoudias, who is a research lecturer at KIOS Center of Excellence at the University of Cyprus.
Happy to be here.
Welcome. And then it's Stella Karra, who is
project manager
at the Center for Social Innovation. And then we have Andreas Kamilaris. Remind me, Andrea, what do you do?
It's Periopsis.
Who is the director of Periopsis, but he's also a team leader, a research team leader at the Science Center of Excellence. Sorry, I had to rattle you out. And then we also have, this is the most difficult of the last names, Ireneos Abdelkater. I said it right.
Yes.
From the smart city of Pafos, Ireneos.
Correct.
Correct? Okay, so welcome all. So, why are we here for this panel and why am I moderating it? I wanted to introduce the fact that Nicosia and Cyprus now have an EIT community hub. It is community hub. And from EIT, we pay attention to innovation and taking new products out from the different perspectives into the society. And we want to look at this from all the possible perspectives. There's EIT urban mobility that has to do with smart transport and new solutions that are coming out from that perspective, as well as looking at the environment. There is EIT materials that can be used for sensors and things that we can enhance our environment with. There's EIT digital that is coming with digital solutions. So with the EIT, it is community hub that will be hosted at the Cyens Center of Excellence. We will bring these opportunities to all of you and all of Cyprus and enable new startups and support them into getting funding and having a better impact on the startup of the general ecosystem. So that's why I'm very glad to be here. I'm Styliani Petroudi. I'm the EIT Community Officer for Cyprus. And I also lead the research office at the Cyens Center of Excellence. And I will delve into the questions. I had a presentation for each of the panelists, but you can also find it online. And I think that rather we finish early rather than take it late. So I will delve straight into the questions. And Nadia, you go first.
Yeah. So, as Nicosia municipality, party of the main leader. Yeah.
Yes. The municipality of Nicosia is the coordinator of the project that has set up the Cyens Center of Excellence. So we have a very close and good collaboration with the municipality, and Nadia is actually right next to us, and the digital twin uses information from the smart city platform that actually Nadia leads. So please tell us a bit about the smart city platform at the Nicosia municipality. And how is Nicosia integrating smart technology to improve urban services?
Yes, thank you, Styliani. Thank you all. I might say that the smart city platform is the last mile for us. The smart city officer of Nicosia and the strategy and what we have done the past 5 years may say in Nicosia, and we're very proud about as a municipality. I think it's the most important part, and I will come to the platform by then. Our slogan is the smart by design. So what we start and what we did also with the mayor and all the municipality and the director is we start implement ICT solutions in all of our new structural funds and new design and roads that we did in Nicosia. I think you see the transformation of the city the last years of Nicosia, Eleftheria Square, the commercial district inside the walls, all the area where we are also built here, Agora and Stoa, and our offices, the new town hall. So what we have done, we implement all this infrastructure of fiber optic network. We are the first municipality in Cyprus that we own our own fiber network. And we built up all the ICT solution in a small scale, may I say, but in a very important knowledge that we have now after three year implementation in the smart parking applications, Wi-Fi systems, waste management, lighting controllers, information technology, and also other solutions that were all set up in the smart city platform, so to come there, which is a tool for us in order to communicate, to have all these systems. Also now we integrate other system above of the smart city platform with BI tools and other that we want to have it all an open data. So this is also the aim of the municipality. We have three piles, may I say. The first one is to have the infrastructure inside the municipality and the offices, the other departments of the municipality to have this information in order to do their daily life. The second one is the open data in order to be connecting and collaborate with Center of Excellence, of course Cyens, you told we are together, but also with KIOS and other Center of Excellence. We're full open and we want to collaborate with all the community and the startups, which is our next plan. And the third one, of course, is the digital transformation of the municipality. So you combine all and we are trying to build up and explore all these suggestions of the smart city of smart Nicosia.
Great. Thank you. I think you've also answered part of the next question, but you can tell me a bit about how you foster the public engagement to support these initiatives?
Yeah, it's a key, I think, element in all this. We cannot say that we're doing smart cities if we don't have the public opinion and involvement of all the cities. So that's why we make some key decisions for the project. First one, to have a big marketing plan in order the citizens know what it's about. Okay, they walk in the city and they see some blue signals of free Wi-Fi, or we have a lot of announcements, even us or the mayor or other people. But still, it's not enough. We need to push, and I think in order to have that, we need to come again and have an open communication with the citizens to bring them inside, as we did as well. We are doing a lot of times with the European projects, with you as well as science and all this, and to listen them, what they need. For example, okay, we know that's the first priority always the parking, the smart parking or the mobility things, it's a high. So that's why what we have done, okay, we have this application, we now want and we expect from the ministry to open it and to continue all this collaboration with the Smart Cyprus that Elena will explain later. And also to have other citizens. Now, in the next few months, we're going to have an app for the διαχείριση παραπώνων, sorry about the
complaints
in the citizen. It's going now to be installed in the next few months for the Nicosia. And also that the smart waste app and other things that citizens can interact with us and have all this information live. And also through our website of Smart Nicosia.
Okay, thank you, Nadia. Elena, so how does, I'm going from the city to the ministry. So how does the deputy ministry envision Smart Cyprus? What role does the deputy ministry play in shaping the policy framework for smart cities in Cyprus and for Smart Cyprus? And how do you ensure that these policies drive innovation?
So, Smart Cyprus is a 12-year plan of the Deputy Ministry, which basically consists of setting up a smart national city platform and implementing initially four vertical solutions on it. These four vertical solutions have been identified by the municipalities themselves. They have been asked. And these solutions are smart parking, smart lights, smart waste management, and citizen app. We have announced a tender last November. The tender is still open. And through this tender, we're a platform manager will be chosen who will provide all these services. The tender is being funded by RRF, and its budget is 35 million euros. And after, at the second stage, when the implementation of the platform is completed, this platform manager is expected to provide additional services to his clients, the municipalities and government departments who ask for smart city solutions according to their needs. And the deputy ministry will be a regulator of the prices, will be monitoring the prices of these additional solutions. This is the plan.
So there goes the policy and engaging across the different sectors. And also if we pay attention, it's like co-creation with the complaints and involving the citizens, the environment with smart parking and the smart waste. Mm-hmm. And which one is the other one?
Smart lights.
So that also helps with and CO2 and also with the environment, maybe also with safety. So that's something
and
that...
And this is only the beginning.
Okay, great. Thank you. Thank you, Elena. Stella. Yes. Hello.
Hello.
So I'm going to go specific with you.
Okay.
So can you describe a project initiated by the Center for Social Innovation that exemplifies the impact of the smart city technologies on the welfare of the community?
Yes. First of all, to say that this organization and our perspective on smart cities is to prioritize on... it's okay?
Yeah.
Okay. Inclusive innovation, community engagement, and ethical considerations. So having this in mind, we have different initiatives through EU funding projects. One of them is the Digit for All, which calls digital skills and computing for all. So we're trying to raise awareness how to improve the digital literacy and also their digital skills. And this project aims to develop a guide for the trainers, how to teach them to improve their digital skills, but also to create workshops which are already running with the multi-purpose centers of Nicosia. And we are really aimed to improve the quality of life by improving their digital skills. So then to be ready when the city converts into smart city, to be able to understand these technologies. Also, we have the Alive project, who again aims to improve the competencies in media and digital literacy. So, but this has the target group above for seniors, so above 40 years old, but still learning them how to use different platforms and technologies. So again, to prepare them for when the cities are getting into smart cities, to be ready to understand these technologies.
You said seniors above 40 years old.
No, I'm sorry. That's
it. So, yeah. Maybe there's one that isn't a senior on this line. Maybe you, Reno. No, you're a senior as well.
I'm not.
Ah, you're not, okay. You're not a senior.
Almost.
Okay, but it's nice that we have this literacy, the digital literacy that is needed so that the citizens can take advantage of the smart cities.
Yes.
Okay, so from your experience then with dealing with young people and seniors, okay. What are some effective strategies for integrating social innovation into the broader smart city planning process to make sure that it addresses the real problems that people, the citizens, face?
Okay. First of all, it's quite crucial to understand the needs of the community. So it needs a comprehensive approach. And I agree with Nadia that we need to engage the community in order to understand their needs, because we have diverse needs in different cities, so we need to understand these needs. And by involving them in different decisions, then they build trust with the government and the municipalities. So then I really understand that this community could be part of the decisions. Then another strategy that we follow is to build partnerships with local government, sectors and government and other NGO organizations in order to improve the planning and to make better decisions. Another strategy is to implement a small-scale piloting. When you have something already made, in order to make sure that this could work in the wider audience and city scale. So it's good to have small pilot implementation. And then to another strategy is to build capacity, knowledge to the people, to the citizens, and make them sure that they understand the priorities of the cities, but also for the municipality staff or the government staff to understand the priorities of the cities. And by offering this knowledge, it's good to understand and making better decisions for all.
Okay, I like this, top down and bottom up. Okay, great, thank you. And now we'll go to Andreas. Hello, Andreas, again. So, tell us a bit about Periopsis and how does Periopsis contribute to the development of smart city solutions? What are some of the innovative technologies you're working on? I know the answer, but I guess the audience is also interested in finding out.
Well, I hope so. Periopsis is a spin-off of the Cyens Center of Excellence. So part of the research that we do at the center, we decided to commercialize it. And in this case, the research we do is about analyzing satellite images and using AI models in order to detect points of interest. And right now we have four services. One is about counting trees, which is useful for forestry operators or for urban planners. The other is about recording the area of buildings and swimming pools. So this is useful maybe for the city administrators or for the tax. And we have our flagship service, which is about detection of dumping, mostly illegal dumping, which is, I guess, very useful for local authorities and municipalities. Actually, now we run pilots with most of the big municipalities of Cyprus, including Nicosia, including Pafos, and also Limassol. And actually, we have six or seven municipalities, which all are in the top 10 municipalities of Cyprus in terms of geographical coverage and populations. So the technologies we use, I mentioned them already. We use Earth observation, satellite imagery, together with artificial intelligence and computer vision models. And through a stakeholders' needs-driven approach, we have developed a portal which is used by operators of the municipalities to locate waste, what is the type of waste, what is the volume of the waste, so that they can go at their convenience and without sacrificing resources to go and collect them. So this is the innovation that we bring, and we hope that Cyprus is just a small case study for us because our technology is highly automatic and that soon we will move outside Cyprus.
Okay, I want to make a comment here and then follow on my second question. So this fits very well with the part of the applications about the smart waste, but this is not for the smart waste and actually the bins. It goes to the extra step when you have areas that maybe recognize that someone dumps things and it can be like connected with this. So when there's downtime with the smart bins, you can go and ensure that the municipality is actually clean and well cared for. So this is something that I guess the Cyprus would need to address in total.
May I? Of course. Yes, and because we were discussing before with Andreas, it's a very nice example for the combination of both, because Nicosia has the smart ways. We implement smart sensors in the underground bins of all municipality. Also, we have the collaboration with for the glass recycling with the private Green Dot, which is the only contractor. So the combination, as you said, we have also the smart waste app with what Andreas and the teams in the city are doing. It's the best example of a holistic procedure of the waste management and detection. So it's very good.
Yeah. So, if I can add, I think that is also a good collaboration between local authorities and the commercial world in bringing different technologies together that work in an ecosystem of technologies or supplementary. And while the smart waste project might focus on organized waste inside the cities, we focus more on illegal waste or dumping or even litter, which is placed outside or in the outskirts of a city, and which could create issues such as contamination, pollution, plastic everywhere, especially in coastal areas, etc.
Yes, it's perfectly addressing the quadruple helix for the new fifth member, the environment, doing this. Awesome. Great, Andrea, thank you. I will move to Ireneos. Reno, so welcome. Nice meeting you today. I hope we'll meet again in other occasions to move forward with the smart city. So what makes Pafos a model smart city? And what are the key initiatives that have contributed to this status? How easy has it been to implement a top-down approach? Because I think Nicosia is doing a bottom-up approach, but I think you guys are doing a top-down. Am I correct?
Yes, you're correct. So historically, the economy of Pafos has primarily been supported by two main pillars, real estate and tourism. These sectors have been instrumental in driving economic growth and employment within the region. However, recognizing the need for diversification and sustainable development, the municipality of Pafos, under the visionary leadership of the current mayor, has embarked on creating a third economic pillar centered on education and innovation. This strategic shift involves cultivating culture and developing the necessary infrastructure to attract educational institutions and cutting-edge technology companies. The recent establishment of two new universities in Pafos and the emergence of various tech startups serves as a tangible evidence of the municipality's effective initiatives. These developments not only highlight the progress being made towards enriching the local economy, but also underscore the successful implementation of the vision by the municipal team. So Pafos is frequently cited as a model for smart city initiatives. This recognition is largely due to the city's strategic approach that uniquely combines its rich historical and cultural heritage with cutting-edge modern technologies. We in the municipality try to improve the quality of life, both for the residents as well as the visitors of Pafos. And in Pafos, the smart city strategy is implemented holistically, meaning that new solutions are rolled out across the entire city simultaneously, rather than through segmented trials or beta tests. This approach is unique to Pafos due to Pafos' manageable size, which allows for uniform benefits across all community sectors, but it requires thorough planning and vetting to mitigate risk associated with large-scale implementation. To ensure technology functions seamlessly with existing infrastructure and are compatible across the urban landscape. Some key initiatives in Pafos involve smart tourism, which has been introduced, and Pafos has been credited with the title of European Capital of Smart Tourism for 2023. And we managed to get the title by having initiatives including mobile applications that provide information about cultural sites and events. And we try to enrich the visitors' experience, but also help manage the flow of tourists to historic locations. Other initiatives are green energy projects, which shows that the city of Pafos is committed to environmental sustainability, demonstrated by initiatives such as smart dimmable public lighting and the promotion of electric vehicles with the installation of electric vehicle chargers in all the public parking spaces in Pafos. Other initiatives are urban mobility initiatives which are enhanced with micro-mobility solutions, including rental bikes and electric scooters, as well as implementing a smart parking system to all of Pafos to optimize traffic flow and reduce congestion. So you mentioned the top-down approach in Pafos. So while the top-down approach facilitates swift decision-making and maintains a unified vision, it often encounters resistance from local stakeholders who may feel sidelined in the planning process. Overcoming these challenges involves engaging community members and local businesses from incorporating their insights to tailor technologies that meet specific local needs. It is crucial that these stakeholders feel actively involved and benefit from the smart city initiatives, ensuring both community support and the success of projects.
Okay, so that's where you need the trainings from Stella to support with this.
Yes.
Great, thank you. Now, last but not least, because research is close to my heart, as you know.
Bias.
A bit, not much. So, hello, Christo.
Hello again.
So, how does KIOS contribute to the advancement in infrastructure in and for the smart city technologies, and what are the future directions for your research?
Great. So, the KIOS Center of Excellence at the University of Cyprus is focusing on the control, monitoring, risk management, and cyber physical security of large-scale, complex, and interconnected systems. And we apply that to what we call critical infrastructures. And these include the smart grid, includes the water distribution systems, the transportation network, the telecommunications. So in order to have smart cities, right, you need smart infrastructures, right? So we do a lot of research, a lot of work, first on modeling these infrastructures, then on running the simulations. And there are different, let's say, questions that we would like, let's say, to answer from the end user's perspective. Okay, so we have established at the center a number of what we call a research infrastructure. So there are these test beds of all these infrastructures at smaller scale. So there is, for example, a power systems test bed that has all the equipment and the capabilities to simulate the entire smart grid, let's say, of Cyprus, so that we can study the different effects and impacts in a controlled environment at our lab. Another research infrastructure that we are using a lot, what we call is the KIOS virtual city, that it combines different simulators of those critical infrastructures. So we are able to run different scenarios, simulate some incidents, some disruptions, okay? And we are able to study the cascading effects due to the interdependencies of these critical infrastructures. So the next steps, let's say, in terms of research has to do with the evolution of this kind of infrastructures into digital twin. I mean, the definition of digital twin in our case is the ability to also input real-time data from sensors, not just the historical data that are available, which are mostly static data, but also dynamic data that are coming from sensors. So, for instance, there are already smart water meters that are deployed in Limassol. So we have this close collaboration with the Water Board of Limassol. So we soon we will be able to input this real-time data. And the idea is that with this data, you can refine the models that you have, the critical infrastructure, so that you can do more realistic simulation of the network, do more realistic predictions of what's coming next. Now, all these are being used in different, let's say, projects. One of the, let's say, flagship projects due to the close collaboration with the Public Works Department is the development of a transport digital twin. So it's the Cyprus National Access Point, as it's called, due to a European directive. So this is for providing open access to transportation data, to traffic data that is coming from cameras in the road network, from all the different sensors that are monitoring and measuring the traffic. Relevant to this is also, and this is also related to the citizen engagement that was mentioned before, and is also aligned with the citizen app, that is also planned in this tender announced by the Deputy Ministry. It's called Fix Cyprus, again developed also for the Public Works Department, where citizens get the chance to report incidents that are related to the infrastructure on the network, so potholes or damaged pavements or anything like that. So this is a way to close the loop, get the feedback from the citizens, so they also feel that they are contributing. They can see through this mobile app the status of the report. And we also have something that the maintenance authorities might not like. It's a ranking of the authorities depending, you know, based on their efficiency in addressing those reports. Okay. Yeah. I will not tell you who is winning. Okay.
Who is losing?
No, not that.
Okay. Can we find you online?
Yes. I think yes. You can find online.
Okay,
who's winning,
cool.
Who's losing.
Great. Thank you. I hope it's neither of the panelists here
bottom. No.
Great. So please, we're not at the bottom. Okay. So thank you very much. These were the specific questions to each and every one of you. I want to take, we haven't finished. I want to take the opportunity and just say that, given that outside of the research centers and with the support of municipalities that have the access to the citizens and to all this work, as well as with training, there's different funding that we can have access on in creating startups like what Andreas has done with Periopsis. Through the EIT mobility, there's a Raptor call, and there's a few other calls that will be announced on the EIT Community Hub LinkedIn account, so please follow that on LinkedIn, so I have to do the advertisement for that as well. So now moving on to the general questions. So, in what ways can collaboration between municipalities, government bodies, and innovation centers be improved to accelerate the adoption of the smart technologies in Cyprus? So, can you share your views on how to foster such collaborations effectively? Elena, I will start with you.
Yeah. Well, the state cannot create a smart city on its own. Collaborations are a must, and everybody should participate. Municipalities, universities, research institutions, businesses, startups. I mean, it's a joint venture for it to be successful. So, collaboration between all these institutions can be achieved through certain projects being funded by Research and Innovation Foundation, for example. There are many motives for such, for extra funding for such collaborations. So, yeah, something that definitely has to be enhanced.
Yes, we agree that it needs to be enhanced. Yes. Coming from the Center of Excellence perspective, and I imagine Christos will agree with me that we would very much like that support. Mm-hmm. But also I'm coming to Nadia and Ireneos. From the municipality side, what do you think can be done? Well, you're coming from a privileged position.
Yeah, okay. So I don't know, maybe Ireneos, do you want to start?
Well, I think that collaboration should be fostered both by the central government, but also between the municipalities themselves. It's very important to collaborate in projects both between the municipalities as well with the government and centers of excellence. I think that we are lucky that we do not see projects in Cyprus become a competition, but rather we see that projects are being developed in all municipalities, and we haven't been asked by any other municipality for help in any of the projects that we have developed, but I know that we would be open to helping any municipality or government or any center of excellence by providing data or knowledge or know-how on the projects that we have already developed.
It's just to add on and work on, but we have the same problems. The cities are the same. Okay, we don't have the sea, for example, like Limassol or Pafos, lucky one, but or Larnaca, but the problems of the cities are the same. I think all when we're all together in municipalities, employees, and we're speaking about different things and problems that we're facing every day as public employees, we have all the same. So I think that the best way is to have in mind that the city is the hub. We create like a hub. We work like as a community, and everybody they have their input, even if it's the research team or the startups or the citizens, the schools, the youngs, the old, and everybody contribute to that.
Okay. So,
if I can add something to this, which is a nice example, and it's actually a coincidence that. Me and Christos are on the same board today, is that during pandemics, we had the opportunity to collaborate together, two centers of excellence, together with the government of Cyprus, the Ministry of Health, and also with the Deputy Ministry of Research and Innovation, with the Municipality of Nicosia, which supported us, which was this initiative called COVTRACE-RN. Which was, I was the project manager, Christos was the product owner, and this was a pan-European initiative in order to make contact tracing by means of Bluetooth and to inform others if you had been exposed to COVID. So sometimes maybe work and research and the innovation is driven by the facts, the situation, the crisis. So, but it was a very good story worth mentioning, I think.
Yeah, indeed it is. I confirm that, Andrea.
And it's not the only collaboration that KIOS has with Cyens.
No. I mean the ground is very fertile there. I mean, we're always looking for opportunities to collaborate. I mean, there are also a lot of complementarities. So, for instance, with the Nicosia, the iNicosia, let's say, project, right, focusing a lot on, like creating the virtual environment, the 3D model, and focusing mostly on, the cultural heritage. This is very complementary. We've discussed it in many different occasions with what we see under the ground, if you like, the infrastructure, so the network of pipes, or what you see over the ground, right, with the power lines and things like that. So I think putting this, let's say, together, there is a lot of room, let's say, for synergies and, moving ahead.
Yes, but we're also together in the Digital Innovation Hub.
Correct,
the European
Digital
Innovation Hub.
My bad for not mentioning that.
Yes. That's what I was trying to get you to say.
Ah, right, okay, good.
But that also has the engagement of the citizens, but not the citizens on their own as citizens, but as startups and SMEs. So the Digital Innovation Hub gives supports and trainings for SMEs for evaluating their digital maturity assessment and then giving access to the different infrastructure that is available at the Centers of Excellence so that they can try and they can start some new solutions before they go and they put out the money themselves to do something. But that's for the SMEs. That's where, however, we also need the community. So I know you've mentioned a couple of good cases that were best cases for strategy. Do you want to elaborate a bit more? I want to give you that time because that's really important. Co-creation and listening to the citizens, it's something that we are all for, and we need them to be educated and be involved for us to be able to succeed. Because if we do all this and the citizens and the community does not pick it up,
yes, of course. So we try. It's important to engage the community and make them understand that they will be listened. So it's important to raise campaigns and awareness with them, and listen to their needs, because each city has different needs. So these diverse, different community needs to be integrated within the cities. So that's why we're trying to make these campaigns through or consultation or focus groups or workshops or co-sessions on designing from the beginning of the process, and to make them understand they can participate to the whole process, which is important for them, but for us as well, in order to have the right infrastructure of the city and to make them and to adapt the necessary technologies in order to improve and the cities themselves. So another thing that we try to do with them is to increase the knowledge of the as I said before, of municipality staffs or the governmental bodies or the citizens themselves. So by sharing this knowledge, it's quite important from them and to adapt these solutions in different cities. I think it's important because you understand the local context of each city and the needs of each city.
Okay. Making the citizens...
Sorry, could I also
ask? Please.
I think I should also mention that Deputy Ministry has a very big project called eSkills, which more or less does what you mentioned before, digital training, upscaling, training people for digital skills so that they can use digital services more. It's directed to the whole population, all demographics, but targeted in weaker groups like senior citizens or people in remote areas, etc.
So this I think it's important to improve their skills.
So we also have something.
Maybe we could collaborate.
What Stella mentioned was that they also train the trainers, if I'm correct, which is something that is quite important to have and have this programming.
Yeah, because they also can improve their competencies in different and improve their skills in media or digital literacy, and they can further help their citizens in this way.
If I may add to that, when developing a project, we all face some common issues like securing funding, bureaucracy, and maybe technical difficulties. But after completing the project, for a project to be successful, it needs to be adopted by people. And what we have seen in Pafos is that the single most important issue we face is the resistance for change that people have. And in order to overcome this issue, you need a lot of patience, you need a lot of trials in educating people, explaining to them why this change is helpful for them and how it can help their lives. For example, when implementing the smart parking project in Pafos, people before, the number one complaint they had was that we don't have change with us when we need to pay for the parking. We only have notes, or we have our credit cards or phones. We don't walk, we don't drive with coins, so there's no way for us to pay for the parking. After taking out the coin machines and implementing other solutions, the number one complaint is we don't have our phone with us, we don't have access to the internet, we don't know how to send an SMS. So this is the resistance to change that we need to find a way to tackle and solve in order for people to engage these smart city projects.
I want to make a comment, then you can add. Making the citizens co-owners and having trained them before, I think is quite important, because having trained them, they can understand what's going on, and making them co-owner of the solution, I think, will be how things can be achieved. Stella, go ahead.
It was exactly the same what I wanted to say as well, but also I wanted to add to this, maybe you can demonstrate them how each technology works, so they can understand and then they cannot complain, but also when they be trained, then it's easier for them and to implement each technology, each new technology in their city.
Okay, I have a final question, that how all the panel thinks that this technology and smart cities can actually shape the future. But before going to the panel, I want to see if there are any questions from the audience. Yes, please. Hi.
However, what I have seen, I have come back from my university like 2 years ago, and from what I've seen from the ecosystem, the so-called startup ecosystem here is mostly researchers creating either spin-offs from research innovation centers, which I deeply admire your work and everything, but what I've seen is that there are no chances given to people that are not with like two PhDs, even a master or even robots that know how to code and know how to create solutions. And I want to understand more of how can we basically give those people a chance, because like I'm a new gen of the startup ecosystem here in Cyprus,
not a requirement to have it.
No, it's not a requirement. But
yeah.
When they have to compete with others,
But there's a lot of funding for startups. I mean, special calls for proposals for startups. So I think you should try more.
The recent program, which is mostly targeted towards people that haven't done anything yet, they're trying to just get started, and they're trying to get a product in the market, is just for 10 startups. And if we see the history, startups that coded until now are mostly research-based startups.
So competition is high, you're saying?
Yeah, I think it's not only the competition, it's the approach that we take as Cyprus, a more conservative approach. We don't take high risk in order to get products in the market that are...
Well, there's a big gap because there's no venture capital yet.
Yeah.
And we're working on that as well. The Ministry of Finance is working on that. That's a major drawback. But I think we don't disagree with you.
Yes. We have the Digital Innovation Hub that is actually supporting the SMEs and the startups that have started, but we don't have the trainings and the access so much to the people that are not from the Research and Foundation. Sorry. But I want to say something. There are accelerators that people can apply. Cyprus Cities for startups from the universities, but IDEA and other accelerators don't require that. But that's why we also have the EIT Hub, and it just started. There's a lot of competitions that you can start with the idea by giving like the first idea in, and then you can develop it through trainings, and then there's funding at the end for whoever wins for the corresponding competitions. So you're the audience that we want to have for the community hub. So that's something we want to support. Pani, I know you know more than I do for the generally for the ecosystem.
I'm very curious because now Stefan, what you said, I personally, I'm a technical and have this actually the other way around. We have venture capital fund, at least four. We have people that maybe without PhD actually, we don't have a lot of researchers that may spin up.
No, I think. I don't think you're saying different things. I agree with both of you.
Yeah. We need to check the data in the people that actually got funded from
the. At least for the pre-CET deck, that they have PhD. That's very nice. You gave me an idea about it.
Yeah.
But my question is for KIOS and Cyens. Is how many spin-outs they expected to have? They are working for like 10 years right now. I don't know how many.
No, much less.
Seven.
But six. I'm not here for science. Six.
Okay, KIOS is more. KIOS is more.
A bit more, yeah.
How many startups they expected to have? How many spin-outs startups like Periopsis they expected to have? And how many they actually have, if they know the guys, maybe they don't know. And the other question is, what about legal issues here? You didn't discuss anything, for example, the AI European Act, because all of these were discussing innovation, technology, and it's and if it will come into policies, we need, first of all, we need a better spin-out law or a new one.
Which is on the way.
Yeah, it's actually, the first draft was deposited in the parliament right now. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but it's something that we discussed the last 10 years.
I know.
And how will this transfer to the legal aspect, though, on the laws and on the policies?
Yeah. I don't know if you guys want to reply.
Yeah, if I can say about the legal part. I mean, we've at KIOS we've recognized the need, right? And we recently started looking and recruiting people with a degree, with a legal background, degree in law, essentially to help us, you know, better understand, because we come from a completely different discipline, right? I mean, as researchers, me personally, we like to do the technical work, but then there's a lot that you need to take into consideration when it comes to handling data, right? I mean, most of the solutions we are developing are data-driven solutions, right? I mean, we are extracting knowledge from data. These data are generated by humans, okay? So we need to respect everything that is there in the legislation, That's why we are hiring people now. I mean, already we have one or two people with a degree in law working at KIOS, especially to follow all the developments and making sure that, you know, all our research work or our, let's say, activities towards innovation and exploitation abide by what is described in these acts, the AI Act or GDPR, let's say, in general.
Mm-hmm. We have support from outside the organization for this, but we're not under the same laws, at least the legal, for the setting up the companies that universities are.
Yeah.
So we have it a bit easier there. But I want to go back on what you guys were saying before. I think you're not saying different things. I think, sorry, your name again?
Stephanos.
Stephanos is seeing that there are researchers that their spin-offs can be seen because they come from these research centers and the research centers can actually showcase this. And you're seeing the startups because, and you're seeing that it's not enough because you know how many researchers are in the centers. So it's you're not, it, I think you're both making a similar point from a parallel perspective. I know that Cyens has four spin-offs, two that have already started and two that are on the way. I don't know if you know, Christos, because
six,
this is
six
not...
Six or seven. I mean, I'm not involved really in any of those. There are like six or seven. They've received the funding from the pre-seed calls. Okay, so indeed, that is true. I confirm that it was mostly, let's say, PhD holders, people that were working at KIOS, and, you know, transferring the knowledge and the research, you know, towards commercialization through these spin-offs.
And Stephanie, you should also note that there's a central knowledge transfer office. Are you aware of it? At the Research Innovation Foundation, which also helps transferring knowledge.
And,
okay. So you know
the knowledge is coming, you know, okay. And I see that there is a good ecosystem to build on in Nicosia. But knowledge takes you so far. If you're trying to build a startup, you know that 20,000 is
it's not
like
enough. Yeah.
So that's the issue that I
face.
Okay.
Go to track on this.
So we've been on zero for some time now. So I will. I don't know if anyone has any final words about the smart cities. When is the tender closing?
31st of March.
It closed.
It will close.
31st of?
May.
May. Okay. Sorry. Okay.
May.
So there's that there. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Lovely meeting you.
Thank you very
Enjoy
much.
Enjoy your weekend.
You
and
too.
Thank you very much. And thank you for staying.
Thank you very
cool.
much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.